morning. I want to welcome you to worship on this second Sunday of Easter. And just a couple of announcements before we begin our service. We are practicing physical distancing here in the sanctuary when we record these worship services. I am in this spot and at the pulpit, and Brian is behind the camera, Scott is doing the lectering, and Carol is at the piano. So just want to assure you that we are practicing safety as we record these worship services, and appreciate that you are doing that as well. I know that it's hard for people to be away from their church, but we need to do this for this time so that we are taking care of ourselves and one another. Today, Bishop Clements is delivering the sermon. He gave a gift to the pastors and the people of our synod by recording a sermon for us to use in our worship services today. I will say I'm very appreciative of that because it gave me a little bit of a break early this week to, you know, just take a breather after all of the Holy Week and Easter activities. So, but I hope that message, that sermon from Bishop Clements speaks to each of you today. Easter flowers are beautiful, and we will have the list of those who have donated the Easter flowers in the next Herald of Peace, which will be coming out early in the week. The deadline is today, Sunday. If you have any information, please get that to the church office. And if you did sponsor Easter flowers, we invite you to pick them up this week, early in the week if possible. And just call the church office ahead of time, or as you pull in if you have a cell phone, so that we can set the flowers outside for you to pick up. And also, we have a number of Zoom events taking place in the church. We're going to be on Tuesday doing the Bible in a Year discussion sessions by Zoom, and we have the Isaiah Bible study starting up this afternoon by Zoom, and some other things that are taking place by Zoom on our computers. If you're interested in participating in any of those, please just let me know and I will make sure you get an invitation. Among the staff, we rolled that out by Zoom this past Tuesday and had 11 people participate, and it was a great conversation. If you're interested in having your name added to the list to get an invitation to participate in Among the Staff, just send me an email, a phone call, a text, whatever, and I will add you to the list that will go out on Monday. With that, I would just draw your attention to the additional announcements and the week's calendar that is printed in today's bulletin. And we will begin our worship by singing, "Come You Faithful, Raise the Strain."
Thank you.
Christ in the waters of baptism, we are raised with him to new life.
We give thanks for the gift of baptism.
We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning you created us in your image and planted us in a well-watered garden.
In the desert you promised pools of water for the parched, and you gave us water from the rock.
When we did not know the way, you sent the Good Shepherd to lead us to still waters.
At the cross, you watered us from Jesus' wounded side, and on this day, you shower us again with the water of life.
We praise you for your salvation through water, for the water in this font, and for all water everywhere.
Bathe us in your forgiveness, grace, and love.
Satisfy the thirsty and give us the life only you can give. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
A reading from Acts, the second chapter. But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them. Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with deeds of power, wonders, and signs that God did through him among you, as you yourselves know, this man handed over to you according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God. You crucified and killed by the hands of those outside the law. But God raised him up, having freed him from death, because it was impossible for him to be held in its power. For David says concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand so that I will not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad and my tongue rejoiced. Moreover, my flesh will live in hope. For you will not abandon my soul to Hades, or let your Holy One experience corruption. You have known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. Fellow Israelites, I say to you confidently of an ancestor, David, that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Since he was a prophet, he knew that God had sworn with him an oath to him that he would put one of his descendants on this throne. Foreseeing this, David spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, saying, he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh experience corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that all of us are witnesses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please read with me responsibly Psalm 16. Protect me, O God, for I take refuge in you. I have said to the Lord, you are my Lord, my good above all other.
All my delight is in the God that are in the land,
among those who are noble among the people.
But those who run after other gods shall have their troubles multiplied.
I will not pour out great offerings to such gods, never take their names upon my lips.
O Lord, you are my portion and my cup. It is you who uphold my lot.
My boundaries enclose a pleasant land. Indeed, I have a rich inheritance.
I will bless the Lord who gives me counsel. My heart teaches me night after night.
I have set the Lord always before me. Because God is at my right hand, I shall not be shaken.
My heart therefore is glad, and my spirit rejoices. My body also shall rest in hope.
For you will not abandon me to the grave, nor let your Holy One see the pit.
You will show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy, and in your right hand are pleasures forevermore. A reading from 1 Peter, the first chapter. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, unfading, kept in heaven for you, who are being protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, even if you know for a little while you have had to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, being more precious than gold that, though perishable, is tested by fire, may be found in result in praise and in glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Although you have not seen him, you love him, and even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with the indescribable and joyous, glorious joy. For you're receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
According to St. John, the 20th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe. A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe. Thomas answered him, my Lord and my God. Jesus said to him, have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written, so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
And now I have a special children's time for the children. Thomas was not there with the other disciples when Jesus went and into the locked room and gave the other disciples his peace and helped them to know that he was risen from the dead. Now, I thought that in this time, it's an interesting parallel that the disciples were in a locked room, and well, maybe we wouldn't say we're in locked rooms, but we are shut away from others. The disciples were shut away from others because they were afraid. Jesus had been killed and they didn't want to be killed as well. We're keeping away from others right now, so maybe because we too are afraid, but very justifiably so. We should stay away from others because of the danger of the COVID-19 virus. We want to stay away from others so that we can be safe. And of course, that's what the disciples were looking for also, to be safe in that time when they felt threatened. So they were in a locked room, and Jesus came among them and spoke his peace to them. So I wanted to show you something today that I have learned to do. Let's see if I'm doing this right. No, I'm not good at this. Let me try it again. I just figured this out today, and so I'm trying to learn something new. There, I had the wrong hands. I have to do it in the right order. There's a lot of things in life that we have to do in the right order, or they don't work out. But look how I can make a tie something and make a bow and tie people together. I think of this as Jesus speaking his peace to bring all the disciples together, and he speaks his peace to us to bring us together, and thinking in terms of tying like a bow. But then there's something else that we can do, and sometimes in our lives it gets to be like there are knots in our lives, things that are very uncomfortable, and just like here we end up, if I pull it like this, we end up with a knot in it. Well, we don't like knots in our lives, do we? Maybe we feel like we have a knot in our stomach sometimes if we think too much about problems, or maybe we get a knot in our stomach if we think about ourselves or someone we love potentially getting COVID-19. Or if we think about how we're missing our friends, we might get kind of a knot in our stomach. Well, here we have a knot. And I think the disciples had knots in their stomach, which is what was making them shut themselves away from other people after Jesus' death on the cross. But then Jesus came among them and he spoke his peace. And look how I can work just a little bit of magic here. And it's not so much magic as it is reminding us that Jesus is the one who holds us together, and he is the one who speaks his peace to us. And so we can count on him being with us always to bring new life and blessings to us. Let us pray. Thank you, God, for Jesus, who died on the cross and rose from death, so that our sins can be forgiven and we can know your peace. When we worry, when we feel knots in our stomach, when we're tense, help us to turn to you in prayer and in gratitude, Lord, for all the blessings you give to us. Help us to know your peace today and every day. And we pray this through Jesus Christ, who is our peace. Amen. Thank you for joining me today.
The Holy Gospel according to John, the 20th chapter. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jewish authorities, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. This is the gospel of the Lord. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. My name is Jeff Clements, and I serve as Bishop of the Northern Illinois Synod of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America. Welcome to my home. Like you, I am staying at home, doing my part to slow the spread of the coronavirus that has caused such chaos in our world. You and I are home today, as our mission statement says, for the sake of the world. We are loving our neighbors in ways that don't come naturally to us. We're used to going out and doing, and not so much staying and sitting. Thank you for what you are not doing in public today. I come to you today with a heart that's filled with gratitude for the life-changing ministries that your congregation continues to do in these challenging days. Whether it's keeping your food pantry open or sewing face masks, our congregations across the synod have stepped up, and our congregations have continued to worship even though we have been forced to abandon our pews. Your pastoral leaders have quickly become proficient at new means of communication. They've been working extraordinarily hard to keep in touch with you and to offer pastoral care from a distance. They're now meeting with your congregation councils and your confirmation classes in front of computers. Their hearts have been broken by not being able to visit in hospitals and nursing homes. They're grieving the inability to conduct funerals. And pastors with children at home are juggling their roles as parent and teacher and pastor, all without clear boundaries. I really admire what they're doing. I'm grateful for the pastoral leadership of this synod, which is why I'm with you today. Lent, Holy Week and the celebration of Easter are exhausting times under the best of circumstances. This year's demands have been different, but no less exhausting. In providing this sermon, I'm offering a small gift of time, which I hope your pastors, deacons, and other pastoral leaders will receive. Today is the second Sunday of Easter. Have you ever noticed that "of" before? Easter is a season of the church year that began last Sunday when we marked the resurrection of our Lord. The church calendar invites us into a 50-day celebration right up until Pentecost, which will be May 31st of this year. Today, 8 days into this season, 8 days into this celebration of Easter, it hardly feels like we've celebrated at all. Normally, this Sunday after Easter is usually a poorly attended one in our congregations. After all, it just doesn't stand up well to the grandeur of what we celebrate at Easter. By now, it usually feels like the party is over. In our sanctuaries, it usually looks like it, too. The lilies and other flowers have usually been taken home, and those that have remained have started to droop. The joyous music that we usually hear at Easter by now would just be an echo. Even in a normal year, it would feel like the party was over at home, too. Our company would have gone home, the leftover Easter ham would have been consumed, and by now, if you had colored Easter eggs, those would be out in the garbage. So here we are this year on the second Sunday of Easter, feeling as if we've missed the party or maybe even had it stolen from us. And we can't even tell if we've got other people in worship with us today, can we? Chances are, of course, that you're not worshiping alone. You just can't see everybody else. And even though we did not celebrate Easter in our normal ways, we certainly can celebrate good news. The good news. Think of it. Have we really missed Easter? Well, maybe we have. After all, we were not there when the angel rolled the stone away from the already empty tomb. We were not there to stand before Jesus to see him with our own eyes or touch him with our own hands. We missed Easter by, say, 2,000 years. Thomas missed that first Easter, too. Thomas was not with the other disciples to see Jesus when he came and greeted them that evening. I do sometimes wonder where he was, because he appears to have been the only one who was missing from the group. The disciples were more or less hiding out in fear. They'd locked themselves in. Maybe Thomas had gone out under the cover of darkness with his face mask and gloves to go grocery shopping. Whatever the reason, Thomas was not there when Jesus came to those others and showed them his hands and his side. I think it's funny, or maybe sad, that Thomas has been called Doubting Thomas. He had no more doubts than any of the rest of his friends. Did you notice? Jesus walks in, says hello, and it isn't actually until he shows them his hands and his side that they recognize him. They had their doubts too. It's just that Thomas has been immortalized by his words, "Unless I see for myself, I just cannot trust that this is true." Can you imagine what would have happened if it had taken place today in the age of the internet? I can only imagine how Thomas would have fared. One of the disciples would have sent him a text saying, "Thomas, we have seen the Lord." They might even have posted it on Facebook. Thomas would have written a comment, "You must be kidding." And they'd say, "No, look, we took a picture." "Well, I'm not so sure. It could be Photoshopped. Unless I see for myself, I'm not going to believe you." And then some of the other Facebook friends would begin to take sides. I'm with Thomas. You guys are nuts. And then there's somebody else would say, nah, Thomas is wrong. He's always wrong. He's been wrong since we were in high school. Isn't that what happens today? Even then, his friends, Jesus' other disciples, might have asked, what's wrong with him? Why can't he just take the word of his best friends? So a week passes, and what a week that must have been for Thomas. It must have been torture. The others seemed so convinced their relationship to Jesus had been restored, but not so for Thomas. He must have felt so empty. For a week, he lived not knowing that Jesus was truly alive, not knowing the truth. And then the opportunity came. They were all together again. Thomas was with them. Jesus comes to them and speaks to Thomas. Words of comfort. Words of proof. He says, touch me as you said you must. Don't be unbelieving. No more disbelief. Believe. The Gospel of John doesn't tell us if Thomas ever touched Jesus. What we are told is that Thomas, right there, right then, confesses his faith, my Master, my Lord, my God. Some have read Jesus' next words to Thomas as rebuke or chastening. I read his words as if they were specifically meant for us today. Jesus said to Thomas, do you believe because you see me? Happy are those who don't see and yet believe. Those words are for us who missed Easter, that first Easter. We didn't stand in front of the empty tomb. We heard no angel voices. We did not see our risen Savior. We had no opportunity to touch his hands or see his side. But we do have Thomas's confession. We have the witness of the church. For 2,000 years, the people of God have proclaimed that it is true. And Jesus said that those who are able to believe without seeing are blessed. I am so glad that Jesus said those words to me when he spoke them to Thomas. Because if I had been with Thomas, I would have been as untrusting and just as skeptical as he was. And today, I sometimes think we're better off not seeing because so much of what we do see is not true, and we hardly know what to believe. Photoshop can make any photograph into a picture of something that isn't real. For me, it's possible that seeing might make it even harder to believe. The point is that Jesus met Thomas where he was with the needs that he had. That's the way Jesus takes care of doubt and unbelief and skepticism. Jesus meets us where we are with whatever needs we have. And that's how our faith is sustained. I am thankful that you are listening to me today, but I want you to consider why you are listening. Why did you feel it was important to hear God's word today? Is it because your parents had you baptized? Is it because your grandmother encouraged you? Is it because you had one particular Sunday school teacher who was loving and wonderful? Is it because you confirmed your faith at some point? Is it because you're part of a congregation that inspires you? Perhaps you've had all these experiences. Maybe they've all brought you to this day. Maybe those have brought you and I together. Or maybe it's none. Maybe it's a God thing. I really missed the choirs and joy of an Easter gathering. But our faith is sustained because Christ meets us where we are every day. There are many, many times that I've heard someone describe the experience that they had at a retreat as a mountaintop experience. Well, that's fine. I've had those experiences too, those times when God just seems so close because of where I was or who I was with or what we had done. But I know for a fact, and from other experiences that I've had, that Christ comes to us to meet us in the valleys too, the low places of life, where we need him even more. When Jesus was raised from the dead, he still bore the scars of the crucifixion. The resurrection did not erase what had happened to him. Jesus comes to us today wounded and fully understanding all of our pain and all of our suffering. That's what I cling to today. Jesus comes to us as we continue to stay at home and shelter in place behind locked doors. He knows the fear that we have right now, the fear of getting sick, the fear of financial ruin, the fear of losing dear ones that we love, the fear of being alone, the fear of death. These 50 days of Easter are not going to feel like any that we have experienced before. But we can, in fact, we must, stare into the face of our own fears and mortality with confidence, because we know, we believe that Jesus conquered death and that ultimately we have nothing to fear. Even though we cannot stand face to face with Jesus, I hope that you will trust his promises. Jesus comes to you where you are, knowing your needs, to give you peace. Amen.
Thank you to Bishop Clements for our sermon today. We will now sing our sermon hymn, We Walk by Faith.
Eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light,
true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophecies. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen.
Uplifted by the promised hope of healing and resurrection, we join the people of God in all times and places in praying for the church, the world, and all who are in need.
Open the doors we close, O God, when we fear those who worship you in different ways. Guide us to unity and harmony, that we may come to respect and cherish our commonalities. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Open the paths we ignore, O God, when we prioritize financial gain and convenience over listening to the groaning of the earth. Inspire all to care for the world you have made so that living things might thrive. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Open the rooms we lock, O God, to those who live without a homeland or a place of safety. We pray that generous nations offer refuge and peace for all. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Open our hearts we close, O God, to the cries of those in pain. We pray for those isolated physically and emotionally through incarceration, addiction, mental illness, chronic suffering, grief, and all in need. We lift in prayer all those who are sick with the COVID-19 virus, as well as Karen, Jill, Jim, Jay, Scott, Izzy, Lindsay, Betty, Celeste, Rick, Carrie, Don, Judd, Jean, Sarah, Becky, Dawn, and those whom we name now.
Pat.
Ronnie. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
During this Easter season, we give thanks for the new life you give through Jesus' resurrection. We also give you thanks, O Lord our God, for these blessings.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Open the ways of love, O God, in the pursuit of peace throughout the world, and bless the efforts of missionaries, healthcare professionals, activists for women and children, and relief workers, especially those who find themselves in harm's way. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, in this time of the pandemic, it's hard for so many of us to be separated from loved ones and friends, to be at home when we would rather be out doing other things. We pray, Lord, for the containment of COVID-19. We give you thanks for healthcare workers and for all in essential work, for those who work in grocery stores and gas stations, and other places to meet all of our needs. We give thanks for those who work in food processing and industries that are creating ventilators and PPE and other things that are so needed at this time. Lord, we ask you to be in the midst of all of this, to continue to be with us, and continue to meet all of our needs and all the needs of those who give so much at this time. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And we pray for all those who are suffering from storms at this time, snow as well as tornadoes and other devastating kinds of storms. We just ask that you be with them, to continue to sustain them with hope and meet the needs of those who intervene to meet the needs of others. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Open the way to eternal life, O God, as we remember those who have died in faith. Free us from the fear of death, that we embrace the peace you have promised. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
With bold confidence in your love, Almighty God, we place all for whom we pray into your eternal care, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share the peace of God with those in your household. Peace be with you, Scott. Carol, peace be with you. Brian, peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
This time we continue with the offering. We cannot make our offerings in person today, but I do encourage you to continue to make your offerings to the church so that we can continue the vital ministry of Prince of Peace Lutheran Church. We do appreciate, I appreciate, all those of you who have been faithful in your offerings, those of you who have mailed offerings or dropped them off, placed them under the rock next to the door of the church, and those of you who have given either through your bank, automatic bill pay kinds of giving, as well as those of you who are giving through Tithely. That is an option on our website. There are a number of options for you to continue to make offerings, and we appreciate all of them as we continue to seek to do God's work through the Congregation Prince of Peace. Now let us sing our offertory canticle, Hallelujah, Jesus Lives. In our lives.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory,
forever and ever.
Amen. And now receive the benediction. May the one who brought forth Jesus from the dead raise you to new life, fill you with hope, and turn your mourning into dancing. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. We sing hymn, Thine is the Glory. Alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia.